If you scale up 1,000 years from now, you could imagine it becoming God, like a godlike property, like an unstoppable force that has access to every element in known space. What is your take on all this UAP disclosure stuff? Do you give it any mind at all? Or are you busy with like real stuff?
No, I mean, the thing is, there's a thing called the Fermi paradox.
Yes.
Which I think we talked about before on the show.
Yes.
Which is, and the paradox is, if we haven't seen it, let's assume we haven't seen any evidence of anything. That's a paradox. Because as I said, we now know, we didn't when Fermi first posed it, by the way. We now know there are so many planets out there. So let's say trillions of planets in the Milky Way. Milky Way's been there for over 13 billion years, pretty much the age of the universe. So if there's no one else out there, then the question is why? Because there's been so much time and so many places for civilizations to become space-faring civilizations.
Right.
As Elon talks about, multi-planetary civilization, we're very close to becoming a multi-planetary civilization. And once you have become a multi-planetary and multi-stellar civilization, if you become that, you're immortal, basically, essentially.
Mm. Right.
So the question is, the paradox is, why does it appear nobody has done that? So the first thing to say is, I would not be surprised. Right, if a UFO landed here now in the parking lot, I'd actually, not only would I not be surprised, I'd be relieved, actually. Because I'd be like, this is good, because it'd be a weight off my shoulders, because I'm worried
that we're the only ones. That's a terrifying scenario.
And we're going to make a mess of it.
Yeah.
And so I'm worried we could talk about
but
that.
But isn't it bizarre? Like, one of the things that's fascinating about looking into the night skies, because it's so humbling, because it's so immense, it kind of puts everything into perspective, and it just gives you this like different view of the world. So the universe is so vast and so spectacular. Why is it so important that we exist? To us, it's so important that we exist. And if we make a mess of this and we wind up dying, the universe is so big. If we were the only intelligent life in the universe and it didn't matter, we blew ourselves up, like, it's just a weird aberration that's attached to a survival instinct. Like, we're a weird biological aberration.
So if you think about, let's assume, so we didn't finish the UAP thing.
No, we'll
so,
get back
so
to
I was
it.
Just we'll saying, yeah, so I don't know about that. But anyway, let's assume, just for the purposes of this, that we're the only ones in our galaxy, let's say.
Okay.
Then I would argue that whatever it is, it self-evidently exists because the universe means something to us. I would argue that it's a property of complex biological systems. So whatever it is, it's something that emerges, in this case, from human brains. It self-evidently exists. Everyone who's listening to this knows that the world means something to them. So I would argue that if this planet is the only planet in our galaxy where complex biological systems exist, right, at our level, then it follows it's the only place where meaning currently exists in a galaxy of 400 billion suns. And therefore, I would argue, just for that very basic point, that we have a tremendous responsibility in some sense. And then, you know, if someone lands tomorrow, as I said, I'd be very delighted, because then what I just said would be false. And we could relax a bit and go, it doesn't really matter if we destroy ourselves to some extent. It's not necessarily true that life is temporary, because you could imagine a situation as you go into the far future. Let's imagine that we continue for a million years or a billion years as a civilization. Imagine what we could do. It is possible that life can get so advanced in the universe that it can start to manipulate the universe itself. So, or at least stars. He said you could imagine, for example, just imagine, really wild speculation, but imagine life gets so advanced that it can start to change the destiny of a star. Maybe it could start to add material into the star or something, you know, whatever. So we don't know how to do that or if it's possible, but imagine it could. Then the evolution of stars, life would matter in the sense that it could start to change the way that the universe behaves on a large scale in the future. But if you think our civilization has been around for, 10,000 years at best, really, give or take, and in that time we've sent stuff out of the solar system, we can manipulate planets. So we are changing the way this planet operates. Life has changed it. You know, the oxygen in the atmosphere, before we appeared, the oxygen in the atmosphere is a product of life. So life already, we know, changes planets.
And you could also make the argument that intelligent life might be the universe's way to force change. That intelligent life seems to inevitably, like intelligence itself, must come out of curiosity, because otherwise there's no reason to seek information. So intelligent life consistently seeks information and then constantly demands innovation. Like, intelligent life is not satisfied with the iPhone 14 and wants the 15 and wants the 16 and wants to keep going forever and ever and ever. Well, if you scale that up, you get this current dilemma that we're in with just artificial intelligence and the concept of sentient artificial intelligence and then quantum computing. And you get insane amounts of computing power powered by nuclear reactors that are essentially a life form. Well, if that thing says, you guys are doing it all wrong, I got a better way, and it starts making better versions of itself because it's sentient, if you scale up 1,000 years from now, you could imagine it becoming God, like a godlike property, like an unstoppable force that has access to every element in known space.
I'm really interested in these kind of arguments. You put it really well, actually.
It's fascinating, right? Because it really scales up. If you go from, look, just in the time that human, like in the 4 billion years, which is a blip in the universe, right? But if just take that, okay, life has been around for what, 4 billion years?
Yeah.
That's not that long. So 4 billion years, we've gone from single-celled organisms to the James Webb Telescope. Hmm. We have Starlink. We have electric cars. It's like bananas.
Yeah,
you could imagine if we had another 10 billion years to exist.
Well, exactly. And this is the point that David Deutsch made in the book I've just been reading, and John Baron Frank Tipler made before that. That although it sounds insane,
right,
as you said, and that 4 billion years, there's a lot to say about that, by the way, because for 3 billion plus years of that on this planet, it was just single cells. And so it's only in the last, let's say, a billion years, but actually a bit less, that we've had multicellular organisms. So 3/4 of it at the time were just single celled.
That's even crazier.
So, which is one of the reasons that many people think civilizations might be rare. Because if you just, the only evidence we have is this planet.
Right.
And the evidence on this planet is that single celled life is sort of the way that things are for most of the history. And then, so it seems like an accident in a way that happened late on in the history of life on Earth that produced multicellular life. Is that typical? We don't know. Maybe it took a longer time here than it might do somewhere else. But if it's typical, I mean, 4 billion years, you said it's not a long time. It is a third of the age of the universe. So here,
when you put it that way, it's a long time.
one third of the age of the universe to go from the origin of life to a civilization.
Mm.
And so what was required here on Earth was that unbroken chain of life remained unbroken for a third of the age of the universe in a violent universe. You know, we know there are impacts from space. Many stars are significantly more active than the sun. So the sun's kind of quite a boring little star that just ticks along. It's very nice to us. We're also on the edge of the galaxy, by the way. We're not close in. If you go into this region where that black hole is, there are a lot of stars around. There are supernova explosions and all sorts of stuff going on. So it's violent in there. So maybe you can only get unbroken chains of life for billions of years on the outskirts of a galaxy. So there are fewer stars and planets out there. And maybe even then you need to be fortunate.
Well, also, aren't we very unusual in the size of our moon and the distance?
The moon, that it is big, and so it stabilizes the spin. So the spin axis, Mars, I think, if I'm right, I think the spin axis has wobbled around by something like 60 degrees or something over its history. So imagine that. Imagine Earth was, the pole was wobbling around and everything was falling over. You wouldn't imagine that complex life like us would emerge on a planet like that.
Right. It would be too difficult to survive, forget about innovate. So if you think about the idea that these complex, it seems like one thing you can be sure of in the observable world is that things get more complex or they adapt to their environment. And if you have a bunch of these intelligent apes that are competing globally with the most significant technology in the world, you could see how that would be just a property of the universe, potentially. Although we haven't discovered it yet, like, this is why we're so curious about alien life. Not just because of the possibilities of all the stars, but because we kind of see what would happen with us if we keep going.
Yeah.
You know, that might be just what the universe does. The universe creates intelligent people that create artificial intelligence that becomes far superior and literally is a part of the whole process of creating the universe itself.
Yeah, an evolutionary biologist would say the counter argument is that what life does, what evolution does, is produce organisms that are well fit to their environment, right? So they fit niches in the environment. But there's no drive to complexity. There's no law that says that the more complex you are, the more likely you are to survive and flourish. And the example of life on Earth probably backs that up. Right?
So if
you
talk biologically.
3 billion years of single cells. What that means is that the single-celled organisms were just doing very well.
Right.
And so it's not obvious. It's not a given that just because you suddenly get more complicated, you're better than the single-celled things.
Right. So there could be planets where life never evolves past single cells, but life exists.
Earth was almost that.
Right.
So you go back 1 billion years from now, and Earth was that planet. So the interesting things had happened, photosynthesis, complex biochemistry. But as far as we can tell, nothing more complex than a single cell.
Mm.
So that's most of the history of life on Earth. So that might suggest that that's the way that things are usually. We don't know.
Right.
But we've got one example. The other observation, though, it goes back to your first question. It is true that we do look sort of systematically for signals or evidence of civilizations out there. There's the Breakthrough Listen Project, and there's your SETI, is it called? Yeah. So we do. And we haven't seen anything, I would say. So, and I know that if you go onto the web and things and the internet, people say we've seen stuff and I've seen stuff. But just the basic point, as far as I know, scientifically speaking, we haven't seen anything at all compelling.
No,
basically nothing.
Basically nothing.
And so astronomers have a name for it. They call it the Great Silence. And it's a tremendous mystery, as I said earlier. But it does seem that the universe is quiet, as far as we can tell.
Is it possible that we're looking for something that is not applicable to this particular type of civilization?
Yeah, there are different. So the counter arguments when we say we've seen nothing, therefore, as far as we can tell, there's nothing out there. You could say, well, what if the civilization evolved is far ahead of us? What if the space probes are the size of an iPhone?
Right.
Well, that's kind of a reasonable thing to say, actually.
Because sure.
Why would you not, if you can build a little thing,
right,
that it's easier to send around the galaxy than a big thing?
Yeah.
So why would you not, as you said, these hyper ultra intelligent quantum computers, why would they not be tiny?
Right.
So you could say that. So you could say, well, that maybe they are. Maybe they're all over the solar system, but they're the size of phones and we wouldn't have seen them. And okay.
Yeah.
You would have to concede that. So we're just saying that the way that we've looked for energy signatures, for example, of civilizations, you tend to look for big things because that's all we can see. And we don't see any big things. We don't see any big structures. We don't see any evidence of spacecraft and all that kind of stuff. But I could make an argument that, well, Why would the spacecraft be big? Because as you said, it's another thing you said, actually. It's interesting that we're on the verge now of creating things, artificially intelligent things, which are smarter than us. So I think everyone agrees that we're on the verge of doing that, right? Artificial general intelligence. Some people might think it's further away than others. Yeah, you've probably had people on the show who said it's 5 years away or 2 years away or 50 years away, but it's probably not 10,000 years away, right? So that, which is the blink of an eye. Once you've done that, and once you've got those things, I find it hard to believe that if we get that far as a civilization, we won't begin to send those things out to the planets and ultimately to the stars. So we'll begin that process if we survive long enough.
Sure.
And it shouldn't be too much longer. Might be 100 years, might be 10,000 years, but, you know, we should do it. So it becomes a powerful question. So why does it appear that nobody's done that? And my guess, in the absence of other evidence, would be biology. It's just that maybe the number of places where biology becomes complex enough to do that is on average one, maybe on average zero per galaxy, right? Maybe just civilizations are very, very, very rare in the universe. Maybe that's an answer.